Hey, this is Kieran, Coach's Corner Chats, and joining me is Caleb Paulino. Caleb, where are you at and what are you up to?
Yeah, I'm here in good old Ashland, Ohio as the women's soccer coach for Ashland University, and we're fall break today, so kids are out of class and we're training later this afternoon, so getting in preparation for our game on Saturday against Lake Erie, but they've had the morning off today and probably a refresher for them being in so many games so far. But yeah, things are great here. We're just hanging out, waiting for training.
And how long have you been at Ashland?
Yeah, so this will be my third full season. So I got here 3 seasons ago, August 5th. So I think a week before everybody moved in, I got the job. So it was a little crazy because I was commuting 2 hours one way all fall. My first year. So it was a lot. I got 2 little ones and I would take them to school and that would be as much as they would see dad until late at night. But we made it work. And now the family's all moved over here at Ashland and we're excited to be over here as a family.
Beyond just the long drive, what were some of the things when you came into Ashland that first year, or at least I guess in that first week, that you wanted to start putting into place to lead to success?
Yeah, I think one thing that we asked the group is like, what do you need? I think we had an amazing group of seniors. There were about 12 or 13 of them. You know, they've been a successful program. It wasn't like we reinvented soccer and all of a sudden they were really good. They had been to the NCAA tournament, I think 11 times before I got here. And then they made the NCAA tournament Final Four in 98 with the 99 group. And so there was a history of success. My job was figure out everybody's names at first. I think that was a little bit difficult. Not knowing any of the 30 kids was a little bit overwhelming. But I think, you know, figuring out what they were really good at, figuring out what we could tweak in a short amount of time to make us successful. I didn't want to come in and change everything. I think that was one thing that I didn't want to overwhelm the group is change everything that they've done, even though they've been really successful. I wanted to implement things that I thought were going to help us at the next level and also continue to, you know, build off the success they've had in years past.
Was that level of success intimidating or something that drew you to the job in the first place?
Most definitely drew me to the job. I was at a Division III school at Ohio Northern University for 8 years. I was on the men's side for 5 and the women's on the 3, and there was success there. Right. There were Sweet 16, Elite 8 teams, NCAA tournament teams, year in, year out, conference champions at the school I was at before. And I knew I wouldn't leave that program unless it was a place I knew I could win. So that was a huge draw to me is they wanted to be at the national stage. They had been at the national stage. And, you know, we talked about raising the standard and you've seen that on our social media a lot, the RTS. And that's one thing that I challenge the group is like, I think we're a really good program here, but I don't want us to be comfortable. I want us to want more. So I think that was the really exciting piece for me is knowing them and through the recruiting process and running into Ashland a lot, you know, being at a Division III and then them being at a Division II school. You know, there was a lot of kids that we had been in conversation with as well and lost out to. So but I think that was the exciting piece is that, you know, we're a team that could win. And now how can we take the next steps in our progress as far as success?
You mentioned coaching at Ohio Northern and having the men's side and the women's side. What are some of the similarities and differences when you deal with those two types?
Yeah, I think there's personalities, right? I think, you know, the way that one group may approach the game is completely different than on the other side of things, male or female. I think there's things that you have to realize as far as, you know, how you approach the game with each group, I think is completely different. So that's one thing that, you know, I learned as a GA was I was a GA at Defiance College and I was both a men's and women's GA. And the way that we broke down information, the way that we relayed information or ideas was completely different. And I think, you know, you can't go in the same mentality, just like every year's team is different. You know, the expectation from last year and this year, yeah, we returned a lot of kids, but there's a lot of new faces and the way they perceive information or the way they want to be motivated may be completely different. So I had experience early on working with both sides. And I think that helped me as a grad assistant. So I was able to understand like, okay, here's what maybe motivates a men's team or a men's player differently than what motivates a women's soccer player. So I've always wanted to be on the women's side. And I think that's one thing that, you know, I strived as getting out of being a student assistant, a grad assistant, is I thought on the women's side, you could really find a lot of success. And I think that's one thing that kind of gravitated towards me is like, I think relationships are huge on the women's side. I think it's important on the men's side too, but I think the culture and the way you do things and the understanding of the why is huge on the women's side, and making sure that we're relaying that information. So I think that's one thing that we do a really good job here culturally is keeping the group invested and also being in the know. They want to know why we do things. They want to understand if we change something, what's the reason for, not just because Coach Caleb said so. So I think those are things that I've learned as, you know, my third year as head coach is it's, we're always learning. Every team's different. And the way we relay information to even each player is might be different.
You talked about learning a lot early on. What was your experience as a player growing up? Like, when did Caleb start getting the love of soccer? When we start kicking the ball around?
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't tell you the when I started dribbling. I'm sure my mom and dad could tell you that. But I think I grew, that was the sport I was just immersed in the most, right? Like, I was a basketball kid as well, and I had the opportunity to potentially do both at the next level at a Division III school, and I just chose to focus on soccer. But, you know, growing up, I think it just was something that I don't necessarily came easy to me, but something I just enjoyed the most. And I think, you know, if you would have told me when I was in high school that I was going to be a college soccer coach, I'd be like, probably not, right? Like, I wanted to be a marine biologist when I was like 5 years old and realized Ohio, that's probably not the greatest landscape for it. And then I went to school to be an athletic trainer and realized like, man, I really enjoy working with others and I wanted to be in the sports field. And then I just slowly gravitated towards, okay, how could I get into coaching? And originally it was like, how could I be a high school coach? And, you know, I was a health and PE major finally, you know, when I decided to change my major a couple times. And I thought that was the route I was going to get into. And then one of the coaches that was at Wilmington was an assistant while I was a player, ended up being a head coach at Defiance College and asked me to be a GA. And then I got immersed into the college game. And that was something I was like, wow, this is what I want to do. So it was not the path that I probably picked for myself at an 8 year old, but now it's like, I don't know what else I would do except for coach college soccer. So.
How impactful was that your buddy reached out and said, hey, I think this might be an opportunity. Come along with me and see if this kind of maybe might be the fit for you.
It's huge because I think like anything, like you got to get lucky and you got to know the right people. And, you know, just the way this position opened up, you know, the way the graduate assistant opened up, like it was just perfect timing. I actually took an extra semester to finish my student teaching and at Wilmington when I was a player, and I jumped on as a student assistant, and the timing just happened to be that when I was done, the graduate assistant position opened up at Defiance. So I think it's just being at the right place in the right time, getting lucky. Like the college coaching world is super competitive. And I think, you know, everything is kind of aligned for me to be where I'm at today. But I also think like, you know, I've had a really great group of mentors that have vouched for me and helped me grow as a coach. And, you know, I've done a really good job of putting in a good word, knowing that, you know, I got a head coaching job of a team that's really experienced and have been at the NCAA tournament. I had zero head coaching experience. So I think it's just the people that I've been surrounded with throughout my coaching career have helped me learn and grow as a coach and also prepared me to be the next person, wherever job that would be.
When you look back at your playing days at Wilmington, what are some of the takeaways that you remember from that, maybe positive or negative, that you have taken along with you through this coaching journey?
Yeah, I think I was a 2-year captain at Wilmington. When I got there, you know, there were trees dedicated to All-Americans. There were constant conference championships, and there was a pressure and expectation. And you know, I thought we did well, but also like, I think to the standard that Wilmington had once set, it wasn't there. And then I went to, you know, as a grad assistant to a program where, you know, I think one time in my 2 years there, because men and women played the same day, both teams won. So it was always like, you know, how can you get up when one team wins? Then you're thinking about how to make the other team better. So, you know, I think through all of that, like I really press with our players, like don't take opportunities for granted. I tell them I never won a conference championship in my 4 years at Wilmington. In the places that I've been, that's kind of the expectation, is that you're there. And we reiterate the fact that not everybody gets that. You know, you're ranked number one in the country. There are not too many programs in the history of rankings that get that opportunity. So I think, you know, a lot of our like juniors now, we have 14 of them. All they know is that they're really good and they've won a lot. But I also know that there's been a history of success here that has built the program to where it is now. And we had the actual really cool opportunity to speak with a 99 class that made the 98 Final Four. And there were a lot of comparisons in the beginning of the year of they got knocked out super early the year before in the NCAA tournament. We lost last year in the ninth round of penalties in the first round of the NCAA tournament. They end up making a huge run and making it to the Final Four. And I just wanted them to talk about, like, you know, what was the defining moment? What was training like every single day? What was the situation where you're like, we can do this? And I think that was a huge piece for us, is, you know, the family that they've built in that class with the 99 group. You know, it's so funny to see them on the Zoom call and how excited they were just to talk about their experiences and what it was like, and just to be around each other, because they don't get that all the time. So I think, like, everything that I've learned as a coach and as a player, I want the group to not take things for granted, because I think we've built something really special here. But it's taken the people in the 99 class that graduated, that made the Final Four in 98, to help us get to where we are. So I don't want people to lose track and take things for granted, and just make sure that they appreciate the people that have came before them.
How long were you at Defiance at that grad assistant job, and when did you make that next move?
Yeah, so I was there for 2 years. So right out of college, I graduated in 2010. I went in there at 2010 in the fall and went there for 2 years. And then I actually was part-time at Ohio Northern on the men's side, and also a director of coaching. And I got involved in club. So it was a little bit of college soccer and a lot of bit of working with 450 youth kids, which I love. You know, that's one thing that I'm doing now with the club in Ashland. We have a small club called Ashland United, where I'm now working with those coaches and kind of revamping things and giving them more structure. And, you know, I like that balance, because there's so much pressure and expectation to win at the college level. And then you go watch the youth kids and you're encouraging them to do moves and try to beat players off the dribble. And I could care less what the score is for them. So, you know, that was my first experience of the college ranks, is like being part of an actual successful program at Ohio Northern on the men's side. They made the national championship 2 years before I got there. So they were a really good program, and I was able to work with them part-time. And then it became more of a be there every day, because I have done well. And then I made the switch to the women's side, so basically across the hall, when that position opened up. Because, you know, when I first started, I always said I wanted to be on the women's side, learning through my experiences as a grad assistant. And then, you know, things opened up, and now I'm here at Ashland, and it's feel like it's been a sprint slash marathon at times. And yeah, it's been great.
When you talk about being a grad assistant, I'm starting to see posts on Twitter and stuff about people and how the grind. What is that experience like, especially when you said I'm doing both teams? What, I mean, are you just constantly doing all the little things behind the scenes?
Yeah, it was crazy, because when I was there, we had a GA for just men's and a GA for just women's, and then I was a GA for both. So as you can imagine, you know, we're training an hour and a half to 2 hours for one team. So now I'm stacking myself in a 4 hour block, going to class, going out recruiting. And again, a little bit different in as far as like history of the program at like a Defiance compared to an Ashland, right? Like the grind to work to get kids to go there is a lot different than being number one in the country and evaluating kids. So, you know, we're trying to convince kids, you know, when I was at Defiance, to come to Defiance and play and try to compete, right? And the opportunity of playing time was great. Now, you know, we're trying to convince kids, what do you want out of your experience? Do you want to go to mid-major, or do you want to have an opportunity to win a national championship at Division II? So I think that's where, you know, I remember setting up the fields, cutting grass, pulling out the watering system, lining things. Like, I think that's why I still like to be immersed in the little things here at work, even though we have a lot of people that do a lot of that stuff, because I just appreciated, you know, the things that I've learned that, you know, you have to do a lot of work and get rewarded for it. So I think that's the thing that I've appreciated through all this, is I still love to do all the little work. Like, people are like, why are you doing that? I'm like, because that's just the way I was brought up, right? Like, for a short piece of, you know, my youth, it was just me and my mom before my mom got remarried. And I had to fend for myself while my mom was at work. And I think those are things that, you know, I learned the value of being a hard worker and putting yourself out there and making things happen for yourself. And I think I don't lose sight of that, even though the resources we have here are awesome.
What was it at Ohio Northern that kind of was the impetus to say, maybe it's time for me to make a jump and look at going into head coaching?
Yeah, I think when you're an assistant for 8 years at one school, it's at some point you're like, I want to be that person, right? And I think, you know, Coach Batman now is the head coach at the University of Toledo and is doing really, really well. And, you know, as much as I thought maybe it's next year he's going to leave, like, again, he had been there for 17 straight seasons. And he was a big advocate for me when this job opened up to apply. And he said, listen, this is an awesome opportunity for you. And, you know, I was actually on vacation with my family and all of it was done via phone call and Zoom. And I think he was a big reason, probably one of the biggest reasons of why I got the job, is he's like, listen, it's your time. I would love to keep you part of our program. I think you're a huge value to what we do here, but I also know that you are prepared and you're going to be successful. So that's the cool piece of having a mentor like that, is someone that knows, okay, I'm going to give you the freedom to learn and figure out how to be a head coach. And that's my job now with our graduate assistants, is I want you to be here for 2 or 3 years and then be ready for the next piece. And I think that is what he had done for me, and I want to continue to do for others, is I allow our assistants to be involved in whatever they want, as much as they want, because that's my job, to mentor them. And I had some great mentors that allowed me to do that stuff, allowed me to figure out how to do a budget, right? How to plan travel, how to schedule games. Like, I knew all that stuff. So as far as like my preparation, I had a lot of confidence because people allowed me to do those things and kind of be an associate head coach without the title.
The one thing you mentioned too was this is your first head coaching position. What was your selling point coming in? Why do you think Ashland, with the success that they've had, the history of the program, said Caleb's the one?
I bring back the letters that we use in every social media post. It said, you got to raise the standard. I said, there's a standard of success here. I don't know if anybody realizes the potential this group has. And, you know, you don't make the NCAA tournament 10 or 11 years in your program history and get lucky. I think there's something that is an aura about Ashland and all athletics. Like, our women's basketball team won the national championship last year. Football was number 5 in the country last year. We had 8 or 9 teams win the conference championship. I just said that we can't be comfortable if we want to keep continuing to grow. And I think we need to want more from our players. We want more from each other. We want more from the university with the backing of women's soccer here. And I think those are things that I challenged as far as like the mindset. Like, I don't want to participate. I want to be at the highest level and compete at the highest level. And I think that's one thing that, you know, everybody talks about, oh, well, we're going to have a down year because we graduated so many. Well, we graduated 13 my first year and we won the same amount of games. We won 15 games and we didn't blink. You know, this year we've lost both starting center backs to ACLs in the beginning of the year. For us, it's the next person up mentality. And I think we've built that belief in kids that you could probably go be a starter somewhere else, but you're going to get an amazing opportunity here and you have to make the most of it when it's called upon. So I think those are things that we have built and continued the belief in here, is why not talk about being a national championship caliber team? Because we've been talking about it since day one. Like, our goal is to be in the NCAA tournament and be one of the best teams in the country. 3 years later, we're in that conversation. But it's because we've been talking about it since day one. And, you know, we've had an unbelievable season this year, but that's the expectation that we've set daily for ourselves. So now that we're here, and again, don't get me wrong, when we got the number one ranking and it's the first time in program history, like, I am glad we didn't play the next day because it would probably have been an emotional wreck. But I also know that kids have embraced it and said, well, this is what you've been talking about. You know, every recruit that we bring in here, we said, listen, we want to win a national championship before you leave, or at least be in that conversation. And our first class top to bottom has been the freshman incoming kids, or the freshmen here this year. And they have that belief. So I think that's the thing that we probably spend more time on, is like speaking things into existence. And that's been a lot of things that I've been talking about in other social media posts, is if you're not talking about it and you get there, it's going to be overwhelming. But if you believe in it and you speak it into existence, like, it's funny because now you hear the girls are like, I'm going to score today. And then all of a sudden one of those girls scores and like, you spoke into existence. And that's the cool piece, is like, if you don't believe you can do it, or you don't believe that you're that type of person, then it's not, probably not going to happen for you. So those are things that we do a really good job of, is just constantly keeping the message that, hey, we're supposed to be here, and the work that we've done the last 3 years has put us here.
You mentioned not only the success of your program, but across the board as an athletic department. What's that like to be walking the halls with, you know, like you just talked about, basketball is at a high level and football, and just across the board, what is that environment like in the athletic kind of environment at Ashland right now?
It's such a cool community, right? Like, the crazy thing is, you know, we have about 7,500 students. This is about as like small town high school environment for games as you can get. Like, we played Cedarville a couple weeks ago. That's usually, you know, the one of the best teams in the conference. We played them in the conference championship the last 2 years. You know, we had over 500 people at the game, which was unbelievable. I was like, I've never been part of anything like this. And I think you build momentum because you're kind of in a sense competing against each other, right? Like, women's basketball is the standard of success. We want to be them. So we're competing to be in that conversation. And now you're getting recognition from their team, their staff, like, unbelievable job. Great stuff. Like, I think that's the support that you need, and people coming in and stopping in your door and saying, awesome job. Like, I think that's the environment that you want to work in. I think that's the environment that keeps you going and wants you to want more. So, like, I think for us, it's a huge sell in the recruiting piece too. It's like, we win at every sport for the most part. And we're nationally recognized in a lot of sports. And when football or basketball is showing up for our games, our kids are going to their games and building that culture, that environment, that community. So, you know, I think it's a cool experience. I know it doesn't happen everywhere, but I also think, like, now that we've put ourselves in this conversation, trust me, I've had more emails and, hey, awesome job, from people that have no idea who they are across campus. And now I'm starting to build more of those relationships.
The one thing you mentioned just a bit ago was mom on her own kind of raising you. How influential has that, to see her like going to work, trying to provide for you? And then how excited has she been to see you kind of take the role that you have now to impact young ladies and what have you?
Yeah, I think, you know, for me, it's like, I don't take anything for granted. I remember when I was playing rec soccer and I tried out for the first club team in town, right? I don't remember how old I was, but I don't ever forget what she told me. She said, Caleb, just so you know, you don't have everybody's last name. And I'm like, I don't know what that means. Like, what do you mean I don't have everybody's last name? I said, you're going to have to do more to get more opportunities because you're not the big name family in town. And I never knew what that meant, you know, as a kid. And I was like, okay, mommy, I'm gonna go try extra hard today at the tryout. But going back 20 years later and realizing what she told me, I don't take that for granted, right? And again, like, you know, my mom got remarried, and my stepdad, who, you know, I call dad, and he was a huge part of getting me where I needed to be. Like, that's the environment that, you know, I'm a huge family guy. And now that I have two little ones, those are things that are super important to me. nowadays. And I tell every recruit here, like, I have two girls. I want them to be coached, hopefully down the road, by someone who cares about them. And, you know, my girls, after every game, run to the huddle and give everybody a high five. I would trust every kid in our program to watch my kids. And I think that's what we're building here, is a family and what it means to be part of something special. And I think I've learned, like, my work ethic and that part piece of family is, like, you know, seeing my mom doing all that stuff by herself and then getting remarried and having that big family of, this is important to us. Like, it's definitely shaped who I am and the values that I have with our players.
Just to kind of stay on the family piece, you talked about when you first were making the 2-hour drives initially and leaving the little ones with your wife. What has she been in terms of that support piece? We always see here about the coach. We all know that partner in the mix. What has she been as part of this equation?
Well, luckily she was a soccer player at Wilmington as well. So she gets how it works. It was crazy because, again, we were in Florida with her parents. Part of my vacation was constantly being on the phone. And I'm like, Alex, I think I'm going to be the head coach at Ashland. It's 2 hours away. What are we going to do? The first thing she said to me was, don't worry about it. We'll figure it out later. And I think that's as selfless as you can be, is I know it wasn't easy. And, you know, my wife was like, why don't we get you an apartment? And why don't you stay a couple of days there? I said, listen, for the 15, 20 minutes, 30 minutes I see my girls in the morning, that's important to me. And every single day I came back. But I also know that you have to have an unbelievable support system at home in order for us to be able to do our jobs. And my wife has been unbelievable. I know there are days that are harder because the 3- and 5-year-old are probably a little bit crazier. But for 3 months to be able to just keep things at home and make sure everything is going well so I could do what I needed to do, unbelievable. And I love those guys to death, and they're the first people I go to after the game. And I just, you know, I don't know how she does it. She's a very strong individual and sometimes doesn't show the emotion at times. So I know some days I was like, you're probably lying. Today is probably a lot harder than it seems to be, but no, they're unbelievable. They're a huge support system. And, you know, my wife knew what my goal was as far as, like, getting into coaching. And, you know, she's a teacher and we love the Ashland School District, and it's been a great move for all of us. And I'm just glad she's really enjoying her job, because I know that not everywhere is the easiest place to teach. And she said this has been the best place that she's been so far, which is great.
You talked about how important it was to have great mentors, and you talked about the coach that now is at Toledo and how he was so impactful in terms of pushing you to this job. How important it was for you as a head coach to then surround yourself with a quality staff?
I think it's important. You know, Deja, who was my grad assistant the last 2 years, she was actually working a full-time job online. And, you know, this was like 2 or 3 weeks into preseason. I didn't have an assistant yet. And Deja was an all-region kid here. So she was a player and actually played with some of the players that were currently on the roster my first year. So that was huge for me to get an understanding of the culture here, right? And it was a unique experience, because when Deja was a player here, she had a different coach than the coach that took over, or that I took over from. Danny was an awesome human being. He actually passed away from cancer. And those are things that, like, we talk about the reason why we're successful and the reason why the culture is what it is. You know, DK has made a huge impact, and a lot of people love the success that we have, knowing that we're continuing the tradition that and the expectations that DK started. So I think those are things that, you know, are really full circle, is to be able to have a player that played for Danny, have a player then continue his legacy as far as the things that he valued and implement in into our program, and for me to have the opportunity to continue that on. So, you know, Louisa is joining us this year, and she was actually played at UNOH, which I lived in Lima for 8 years and was across the street from my house. So it was really like full circle, small world kind of thing. But she's been a huge value to our program in her first year as a GA here. So it's important, because I think not every time is it comfortable to have a conversation with the head coach. I think you have to have assistants that are able to have conversations and relationships that are different than the relationships I have with players. So I think that's something that we pay particular attention to in hiring staff, is understanding like what value do they bring? What relationships are they going to have with that are different than the relationships that maybe that I have with players? And are they going to be able to be a bouncing board as far as ideas and continue to, you know, buy into what we're doing? Because I think that's always tough as an assistant coach. And the things that I've learned is not all the time do you agree with the things that are made by the head coach. But I also think like you have to understand the buy-in and what we're trying to do. And I'm an open door as far as having conversation and bouncing off ideas. And I think that's not the case everywhere. So I think there's multiple magnitude of things that go on as far as like hiring staff and making sure it's the right fit, just like a player here in our program. So you know, I think we have some good ones here, and hopefully we can keep them around for longer.
The one thing that I've heard throughout is you brought up the team from the late 90s, and now you're talking about a coach that just passed away and his impact. How important has it been for you to embrace not just the group you have now, but the entire program, the history of it, to build on it and bring it up to your GAs and to your staff and to your players and continue to talk about like, look, we're just rolling along and building on what's already been here?
I think it's important. You know, my first year senior class, their goal was to leave this place better than what they found it. And that's something that we've continued to try to build and harp on. When I reached out to the 99 group that graduated and then made the Final Four in 98, you could not believe how excited they were to be, just feel like they're involved again. You know, I think they have their relationship and their close group, but I think there was probably some time where it wasn't recognized. And like, I think that's a staple of, you know, if you start out the infancy of your program and you make a Final Four within the first couple of years, that's only going to keep continuing to grow the program. And I think having them involved and understanding, you know, they talk about what the facilities were like back then. They talk about what the resources were like back then. And then our players are like, really? And then they start to have some more value of things that they have now, right? And understand that, wow, we have it really, really good here. And I think those are things that, you know, I just, again, we brought this up earlier in the conversation. Like, I don't want people to take things for granted. Like, we didn't show up one day and become number one in the country. It didn't happen. It happened over the 20 some years that the program has been successful. And now we're just pushing the program to elevate and, again, raise the standard. So I think those are things that I don't want our kids to lose sight of, is it's the work that you do, not just we're super talented. And I think that's one thing we talked about last week, is like, listen, since I've been here, we have graduated, or kids that have stepped away, have lost about 25 kids through graduation, through kids just deciding not to play anymore. And every year we find new kids to come be part of our program. And I think it's the things that we do, obviously, with talented kids. But I think that's the work that we do every day that makes us continue to get better. So, you know, I think we can find really good soccer players anywhere we go. I think it's really hard to find really good people that fit your culture. And that's one thing that we have spent a lot of time, like, we're still not done with our 2024 class and people are moving on. And, you know, our idea is, we want to invest months into getting to know you and your family, so we know that you're the right fit for what we do here. So, and I think soccer is this smallest piece of why you come to Ashland. It's the academics. It's, is it preparing you for the next piece of your life? Are you going to be prepared to be a professional in whatever track that you're doing? And if you want to be on a really good soccer program, then that's the perk of coming here. So I want kids to understand that our culture is so unique in how we go about doing things that we want to keep continuing to bring in the right kids that we feel elevate that.
You mentioned earlier as well, once that number one tag was put on, you said, I'm glad we didn't play the next day. How did you go about dealing with that? Like, that is it all of a sudden like, all right, this is what we wanted? Or how did you go about and process maybe as a coaching staff? And then how did you get the girls to be like, all right, it's there, but we have to continue to do, like you said, raise the standard?
Yeah, we actually gave them off that day. But it was actually already planned. So it worked out. Like, I took a day to myself and just sat in the office and reflected. My wife and I went out to dinner with the family because it was a unique experience. So it gave us like 24 hours to really like bring down the emotion of everything. So again, everything happens for a reason. We happen to have that day off. No way do I think we're going to jump to number one. I thought we were going to be in the top five, but to be number one was unbelievable. And then like you deal with that pressure, and we had done really well, and then we end up tying a game on the road. What we talked about is everybody wants to write the article and storm the field. I've never seen a team storm the field for a tie, but they did. And I wanted the girls to watch it and embrace it and realize like every day, this is what's going to happen. Right. And we talked about, if you thought you got their best game before because you're really good in the conference, now you're getting everybody's super team every single day. And we can't afford to just be good every day. We have to be great. And that's one thing that we've talked about as a group is you can't cut corners to be great. And that's one thing that I posted on our social media the other day. It's like, if you think that you're going to survive on being talented and not the buy-in, the things we do daily, then you're cutting corners. And I think for us, like after we tied that game, I felt like there was a weight lifted off our shoulder because I thought we were going to drop from number one. And then here we go. The next week's rankings, we're back at number one. So we sat in the locker room. I said, listen, let's roll with this. Let's embrace it. Let's go. Yeah, we are the best team in the country. Let's start acting like it and hold ourselves to that. And I think like there's been a lot more freedom. And, you know, again, we're still undefeated, but now we have a draw underneath our belt. And I think that pressure finally lifted some weight off some players' shoulders. And now we're just like, let's just keep rolling. Like every week, our goal is to go 2-0. If we keep continue to stack 2-0 weeks together, then obviously we're going to put ourselves in a really good position at the end of the year. So I think ever since that tie, like the weight's kind of been lifted as far as, oh man, we got to try to be a perfect record. Well, I think we still have done a really good job of managing it, but you know, I think every day we have to find new challenges for ourselves to get better and not be comfortable.
I was going to ask too, as we're getting closer and closer to postseasons, conference tournaments, and then the NCAA and all that type of stuff, is there an expectation of, you talked about being one of the top teams, is it a disappointment if we don't win the whole thing? Or do you have to have a little bit of understanding that, look, like you said, you're going to get the best of everybody, and understanding that it's a game and weird things can happen?
Yeah. We never talk about anything other than the week. So this week, our goal is to go 2-0. And we talk about that every week. Hey, we got to go 2-0. We have to win four halves. We need two shutouts. We need to win the set piece battle. So we have these weekly checkoffs and reminders to not allow the bigger picture to be overwhelming. If you're thinking about it as, all right, we have two games this week. The goal is to go 2-0. What do I need to do to be in that position this week? Rather than, how are we going to be 17-0-1 to end the year? Like, that's overwhelming. But every week we've talked about, okay, here's our two games. Here's our goals for the week. Here's our expectations and the standards that we need to meet. Go. And we've just been able to stack more of those weeks together. So, you know, again, we talk about the ranking like it's just a number next to your name. Like, there are going to be some really good teams that are just as good as us, if not better. our job is to put ourselves in a position to keep continue that recognition. So I'm not a huge, like, let's talk about, you know, going undefeated. I'm like, let's just worry about this week and see what happens. I think embracing the role of number one has changed the mentality. You know, I know the girls were kind of gutted to draw the game that we did, but also, you know, we've stacked every other week has been 2-0. So we're continuing to hit our goals. So I think those are things that, you know, for us are important, and we try to take the pressure out of it. But I also know they read social media. They look at all the stuff that other teams are posting and how excited they are to play number one in the country. Like, I get it. It's the human in us to be curious. But I also know that we have to make sure that we're meeting the standard every day in order for us to keep continuing to do what we're doing.
When you look big picture, maybe long term, is your hope to be kind of a long-term coach that's there for 15, 20, kind of just leave a legacy? Is that kind of your hope?
As you would imagine, I get that question more now that we're number one in the country than ever. I talk about our values and the things that are important to me. When I was 21 years old and it was just me and my wife, yeah, I wanted to try to climb up the ladder as much as humanly possible. But also, my track record is I was at Ohio Northern for 8 years, and they kind of had to push me out to go take an adventure. I love the win. I think that's important. I love being around good people. I love being in a good working environment. And those are things that are way more important to me and my family. And knowing that my kids are getting what they need through the school systems here at Ashland, my wife loves her job. Like, that is more important to me than what I thought as a 21-year-old. So as you grow older and you have kids and you realize what's important, you know, just like I made that commitment to drive 2 hours home after training every single day, that was what was important to me. You know, the overall making sure my family was taken care of, even though I wasn't there all the time as far as like timeline. Right. But I think for me, like, if I can continue to be at the highest level, you can't get that anywhere. And, you know, people are talking about, well, what about a mid-major and doing those things? I would love that. But also, I know I'm not beating North Carolina or UCLA. You know, you might beat them 1 out of 100 times or get a result, but what other place can you be ranked number one, win 3 conference championships, whether it be the regular season or tournament in 2 years? Like, that doesn't happen very often. So I think those are things, like, you know, I like to win, I like to compete, but I also know we've built something special here as far as the kids and the program and the culture, and, you know, just it all seems to align with what is important to our family and I. And I think, you know, hopefully we can continue to build a legacy that DK and the other ones before him started. And I think that's, to me, that's, there's a lot of value in that.
That's a perfect way to end this chat, Caleb. I really appreciate you taking time to chat with me. This is Kieran with Coach's Corner Chats with Coach Caleb Paulino, and I'm out. Peace.